But all right, when we ended last week, we just finished looking at the parable of the two houses, you know, the house built on rock, house built on sand. And Jesus, he concluded the Sermon on the Mount with this parable to illustrate the wise man's choice. Those who become true disciples, those who have a genuine faith in Christ that finds expression in obedience to his words, they're like a wise man who built his house on a rock. And the way they're like the wise man is that just as a house built on a rock can withstand the devastation of a physical storm, disciples will withstand the great storm of the final judgment. So those who have this true obedience-producing faith in Christ, they will withstand the judgment, just like the person who builds his house on a rock can withstand a storm. Those who never come to a saving faith, who never come to an obedience-producing faith, but continue to live without putting Jesus' words into practice, they're like the foolish man who built his house on sand. Just as the house built on sand cannot withstand the devastation of a physical storm, those who are not true disciples will not withstand the great storm of the final judgment. That's the point that he's making. And he puts that at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, where he's been calling disciples to this radical righteousness that he paints throughout the Sermon on the Mount. Now, the next parable I want to look at in my category of the call to a kingdom decision is the parable of the sower. Now, this parable, it occurs in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, with relatively minor differences there that aren't significant. And it's one of only three parables that's given a detailed, itemized explanation. The other two being the parable of the wheat and the weeds and the parable of the net, both of those occur in Matthew chapter 13. Now, Jesus says in Mark chapter 4, verses 3 through 9, of course, you're very familiar with this, "Listen, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seed fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured it. Other seed fell on rocky ground, where it did not have much soil, and immediately it sprang up, since it had no depth of soil. And when the sun rose, it was scorched, and since it had no root, it withered away. Other seed fell among the thorns, and thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no grain. And other seeds fell into good soil and produced grain, growing up and increasing and yielding 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. And he said, he who has ears to hear, let him hear." So Jesus gives this parable of the sower, and the focus of the parable is on the receptivity and the conditions of the soils that receive the word. So much so that a number of people refer to this as the parable of the soils. It serves as a warning to those who hear the good news of the kingdom. So Jesus is coming, and what's he preaching? He's proclaiming the kingdom of God. He is here as the kingdom bringer. He's ushering in the long-awaited kingdom. And it's a warning to those who are hearing his message not to be like those who are portrayed in the first three soils. Not to be like them. See, simply being exposed to the word, simply hearing the word of God, the announcement and the proclamation of the kingdom of God, that's not enough. One must receive it as good soil, meaning one must respond to it in repentance and with perseverance. It's not enough simply to hear it. You have to engage it. You have to respond to it in repentance and in perseverance. Craig Blomberg, a well-known New Testament scholar, he says this. Oh, hang on. Let me tell you this. I'm off on Blomberg. He comes next. Jesus explains the parable. Okay, he explains the parable to his disciples here in Mark 4, 14 to 20, where he says, "The sower sows the word, and these are the ones along the path." So he tells them the parable. They want to know the explanation. This is one of the three cases where he gives you that detailed explanation. Here it is in Mark 4, 14 to 20. "These are the ones along the path where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that is sown in them. And these are the ones sown on the rocky ground. The ones, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with joy, and they have no root in themselves, but endure for a while. Then when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately they fall away. And the others are the ones sown among thorns. They are those who hear the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches and the desires for other things enter in and choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. But those that were sown on the good soil are the ones who hear the word and accept it and bear fruit 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. So he gives the explanation. This is one of the situations. But here, so this is the idea. The focus is on the receptivity and the conditions of the soils. As Blomberg says, he says, the three main points of the parable thus fall into place. Number one, like the sower, God spreads his word widely among all kinds of people. He comes and he presents the word. It's here. It's for people to hear. Number two, like the three kinds of unfruitful soil, many will respond to his word with less than saving faith, be it complete lack of positive response due to the enticement of evil. Some people you present the word to, they just won't take it. They won't receive it. Why? Because there's another pull. They're being pulled by Satan, and they just said they don't want to believe it, and so they go this way. They don't let the word come in because they have another attraction. He says, temporary superficiality masquerading as true commitment. This is this idea, oh, yeah, I'm in. But as soon as something difficult comes along, I'm out. I didn't know this was involved. You see, and then the third, genuine interest and conviction about the truth that simply falls short due to the rigorous demands of discipleship. This is where the thorns choke it out. Wealth and riches and those things wind up where your person says, yes, I'm in. But these other things come and you say, does it mean this? Surrendering this, giving this up? So the second one is like the three kinds of unfruitful soil. Many will respond to his word with less than saving faith. Explains a little bit about those kinds. And then three, like the fruitful soil, the only legitimate response to God's word is the obedience and perseverance which demonstrate true regeneration or flow out of true regeneration. See, so this is what you're seeing here in the sower, Klein Snodgrass, in his book, Stories with Intent. He says the parable is a description of various responses to hearing God's word and surely depicts the responses Jesus encountered in his own ministry. The parable warns against superficial hearing. You see, this is the idea. You must engage it. You must repent and pursue it in perseverance. You can't simply treat it lightly or casually. It has to come in and be grabbed and wrestled with, and you be transformed. But he says the parable warns against superficial hearing, but it also anticipates real and productive hearing. Real hearing is hearing that leads to obedience. And we should not forget that the Hebrew verb for hearing is often translated in English as obey. C.F.D. Mole, in his commentary, says words may be sound and lively enough, but it is up to each hearer to let them sink in and become fruitful. You've all had that experience, right, where you've been convicted by something. You can ward things off and hold them off and not, but then sometimes something will come in and right to your heart. Well, that's what it means to engage this message and this proclamation of the kingdom. And he says here, but it's up to each hearer to let them sink in and become fruitful. If he only hears without responding, without doing something about it and committing himself to their meaning, then the words are in danger of being lost or of never coming to anything. The whole story thus becomes a parable about the learner's responsibility and about the importance of learning with one's whole will and obedience and not merely with one's head. How many times have I done this? In teaching, you see, and what am I saying by that? I'm saying it's not simply intellectual assent to certain truths. It is believing those truths, but surrendering to those truths. You see, just knowing something is one thing. The question then becomes, will I submit to that? Will I live that way? Will I live according to the truth that Jesus is Lord? And so you have that. All of that's involved there in the parable of the sower. Next one I want to look at in this category, the treasure and the pearl. Now, the brief parables of the hidden treasure and the valuable pearl, they occur together, and they occur only in Matthew chapter 13, verses 44 through 46. Now, I'm going to consider them together because they closely resemble one another. Jesus says in Matthew 13, 44 to 46, "The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field." Again, the kingdom of heaven. Now, Jesus is the kingdom bringer. He's announcing the kingdom. And he's letting people know what is the kingdom like. And he says again, "The kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls who, on finding one pearl of great value, went and sold all he had and bought it." So he went and sold all he had and bought it. Craig Blomberg, I think he captures the meaning here of these parables quite succinctly. Blomberg says, "The kingdom of God is so valuable that it is worth sacrificing anything to gain it." You see, that really is the truth. And not everybody looks at it that way. And our culture and our world certainly doesn't look at it that way. But the truth is, the kingdom of God that Jesus has brought surpasses anything in value. And it's worth sacrificing anything to gain it. David Wenham, in his book on the parables of Jesus, he says, "The parable of the pearl depicts a rich man's search being rewarded by a find almost beyond price." This is something super valuable. Then he says, "The parable of the treasure portrays a poor man lighting on treasure unexpectedly. It is doubtful if we should see any significance in these differences. The significance of both parables lies in the two obvious features that they have in common. First, the idea of finding something tremendously valuable." And that's what the kingdom of God is. Tremendously, surpassing value. Second, the thought of selling up everything to get it. Here we have something that is just surpassing value. Just can't imagine it. Tremendously valuable, like nothing you've seen, nothing you've come across. Well, what does one do? You see, that's in here, this idea of selling up everything, British terminology, to get it. In announcing the bringing in himself of the kingdom of God, Jesus brought to people first good news of great joy, good news of God's promised and liberating revolution, and second, an invitation and a challenge. An invitation to receive the treasure and a challenge to give up all for it. To give up all for it. One doesn't enter the kingdom. One doesn't become a disciple. One doesn't begin on this road by saying and bargaining with Jesus and saying, "Here's how it'll be. I will go out and I'll believe in you, and I may even say that to people, but I am going to hold on to certain things over which I will continue to be Lord. You can have all of these other things. I'll give you this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, but I got a couple of things I really like. I like drinking." Just to pick an example that was relevant in my life. I like getting drunk. You see? So I have this here. Other things people have. I'll give you everything else, but I will not give you this. I will hold this. No dice. See, no dice. Everything. He sells up everything to enter into the kingdom. And that's something that you see here. Of course, Jesus isn't saying that one buys one's way into the kingdom. He's saying that one cannot participate in the kingdom that he is bringing unless one values it enough to give oneself wholly to the call of discipleship. As he says earlier, Jesus says in Matthew 10, 37 to 39, whoever loves father or mother more than me. You hear that? Father or mother? Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter? Oh, come on. Your child? You would die for your child. Every healthy, normal parent. I understand there's all kinds of bentness in the world, and there are people that abuse their children and all that. But you're talking about a normal, healthy parent. Every normal and healthy parent would take a bullet for his kid. Okay, so he sits here and says, whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Do you see the commitment to which Jesus called? He has to be paramount. There can be no competitors. He has to be paramount. In your allegiance, your loyalty, what matters? He has to be there on top. David Wenham, in his book on the parables, he says, of course the kingdom is not something that can be bought. In that respect, the two parables taken by themselves could be misleading and need to be complemented by others, such as that of the prodigal son. But what these parables do make clear is that in calling people to follow him and to give up themselves, their money, and their old lives for the kingdom, calling people to follow him, to fall in behind him. The kingdom bringer has arrived and we fall in behind him as he leads. In calling people to follow him and to give up themselves, their money, and their old lives for the kingdom, Jesus was calling them to incalculable gain and great joy. It is a pearl of value you can't imagine. It is a treasure of transcendent value. Yes, he calls us to give up everything, but what is he giving us? He's giving us something of a value that we cannot imagine. And that's what he calls us to. Parable of the barren fig tree. What is this? The sixth one I have in this category? Of the call to a kingdom decision? All right, the parable of the barren fig tree. This occurs only in Luke chapter 13, verses 6 to 9. Now, it's immediately preceded, okay? The parable is in 6 to 9. But it's immediately preceded by some people in Luke 13, 1, people who are present, telling Jesus about Pilate's killing of some Galilean pilgrims as they offered or were about to offer their Passover sacrifice. That killing probably occurred near the temple as people approached with their sacrifices in hand. That's this idea, he mixed their blood with their sacrifices. You see, so he's saying that Pilate killed these people near the temple as they're approaching, as they're offering their sacrifices or about to offer their sacrifices, these Passover sacrifices. He kills them there. Now, we don't have any extra biblical outside the Bible account of this killing, though there have been several that have been proposed for this and are possible, but we don't have any clear outside account of that. But this is consistent. What you see here, this report of what Pilate did, that's consistent with what's generally known of Pilate from Jewish sources. So it's not like saying somebody say, well, he killed these people who are bringing their... So people wouldn't go, oh, no, Pilate would never do that. No, it's not like that. You see people go, yeah, that's right. That fits perfectly. Wouldn't bat an eye. That sounds like Pilate. So they bring this up to Jesus, and Jesus answers them in 13:2-5. He says, do you think these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered in this way? No. No, I tell you. But unless you repent, see, unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. Then he's going to add one to them. They told him about this murder. And he says, or those 18 on whom the Tower of Siloam fell and killed them, do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others who lived in Jerusalem? No, I tell you. But unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. See, Jesus at the end of Luke chapter 12, in Luke 12, 54 through 59, right before this, Jesus there, he rebuked the crowds for failing to recognize that his arrival brought with it the need for a decision. With his coming, it was now time to choose to follow him in order to avoid judgment. The long-awaited kingdom, the kingdom that people have been looking forward to, is now here, brought in the person and ministry of Jesus Christ, and it is now time to choose to fall in behind him, to become his disciple. And he rebukes the crowds there for failing to recognize that. And you see, in that light, their mention in chapter 13, verse 1 of the Galileans killed by Pilate, it seems like an attempt at self-justification. You see, it seems like an attempt to deflect what's going on by suggesting that judgment is for those kind of people. Well, Jesus, what about those people? Those people that Pilate had killed. You see, it's for those kind of people, implying that judgment is not for them. You see, the assumption behind the comment, when they told him about Pilate having mixed the blood of these Galilean pilgrims with their sacrifices, the assumption behind that comment was the common idea that disasters occur or come on only the exceptionally sinful. That disasters necessarily are God's retaliation for sin. You remember Job's friends? What did they think? Job's friends thought, of course, you're suffering this way. This is because you are exceptionally sinful. This doesn't happen except to people who are exceptionally sinful. You recall in John chapter 9, about who sinned? This man or his parents said he was born blind. You see, so that is the assumption that is behind their statement. Jesus sits here at the end of 12, and he rebukes the crowd for not appreciating and recognizing that in him is the time for decision. And they come up and they say, hey, Pilate over here, he killed these Galilean pilgrims. The assumption behind that being, Pilate killed these people who were exceptionally sinful. Glad I'm not like those people. See, glad I am not like those people. It's this idea of deflecting. And that's evident, you see, in Jesus' answer where he says, do you think these Galileans were worse sinners than all other Galileans because they suffered this way? Well, yes, they did think that. That's why they said it. And so Jesus puts his finger right on the assumption that is in their statement, the significance of that being they're trying to deflect. And then he tells them, no way. He rejects the notion that disasters come only on the exceptionally sinful. And then he brings the issue back to them. Now I tell you, no, I tell you, but unless you repent. So he rebukes them for not recognizing that he brings this time of decision. They say, boy, I'm really glad I'm not like those people. Did you hear about that, Jesus? Did you hear about those people that wow. Isn't that something? The assumption being they were exceptionally sinful. Glad I'm not like them. Jesus says, no, that's not how it works. These kinds of things don't come only on those who are exceptionally sinful. By the way, the assumption behind your statement, that's false. But more importantly, you have to repent. So you think you're going to get me with this idea? No, you have to repent. And he just tells them that. See, unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. They must make a decision. They cannot delude themselves into believing that judgment is a concern only for others, only for those who are more sinful than they are. You see what a trap that is? Boy, I'm glad I'm not like them. I'm safe in my sin. But if I were exceptionally sinful like those people, I'd have to worry about judgment. And Jesus is letting them know that's not the case. They can't delude themselves into thinking that. And he repeats the point by adding the example of accidental death to their example of deliberate killing. And then he reinforces the need to repent to avoid condemnation with the parable that I'm getting to. All right. So he said, Luke 13, 69, a man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came seeking fruit on it and found none. And he said to the vine dresser, look, for 3 years now I've come seeking fruit on this fig tree, and I find none. Cut it down. Why should it use up the ground? And he answered him, sir, let it alone this year also until I dig around it and put on manure. Then, if it should bear fruit next year, well and good, but if not, you can cut it down. You see the context in which he says this. The point of the parable is that when it comes to repentance, all the impenitent, all of those who have not repented, all of those who have not said, yes, Lord, I've been living this way, but now I'm turning and I'm following you. I'm falling in behind the kingdom bringer, the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm turning and giving my life to you and committing myself to follow you. All of the impenitent, you see, are living on borrowed time. All the impenitent are living on borrowed time. The master has gone the extra mile in his patience and in his forbearance. The time to repent is now. One who does not repent, while he has the opportunity to do so, will be condemned, cut down. And as John says in Luke chapter 3, verse 9, thrown into the fire. Craig Evans, in his commentary, he says, the parable of the fig tree illustrates that people will not always have an opportunity to repent and turn over a new leaf. Just as the reports concerning those who died should awaken one to the realization of the nearness of judgment, so the present parable underscores that judgment cannot be put off forever. You have this sudden and unexpected deaths that were raised of the Galileans, and then Jesus with the Tower of Siloam, of the Jerusalemites. The sudden and unexpected deaths of these people, they highlight the fragility of life. Right? They highlight the idea that life is a mist. You know, like you see like a teapot or something, this vapor that appears for a moment and then vanishes. Now, we live under this delusion that we're guaranteed tomorrow. We're going to keep living, and you're not. I don't know how many times you have to see in your life that that's not the case. That's simply not the case. Arlen Hultgren, in his book on the parables of Jesus, he says, set within the broader context of Luke 13, 1-5, the parable of the barren fig tree is laden with a tone of urgency. Laden with a tone of urgency. Pilate's attack on the Galileans was an atrocity carried out upon innocent persons, persons at any rate who are no better and no worse than anyone else. And the killing of the 18 in Jerusalem when the Tower of Siloam fell upon them was random, killing persons neither better nor worse than anyone else. Nevertheless, these incidents show how fragile and unpredictable life is. Therefore, it is necessary for everyone to repent lest they be caught off guard and perish. Now, in our day, we would use auto accidents. We would use all kinds of things that happen to people. You know people in your life. That's how life is. That's how life is. There is an urgency to this call of Christ to come and fall in behind him, to give your life to him. It is not, well, you know, I'll get around to it one day. I'll mess with it. He's saying you're on borrowed time. All of the impenitent are on borrowed time. Let's see how far I can get here. Last one here. I don't know if I have others in this category. This is the last one that I'll deal with today. This is the parable of the tower builder and the king going to war. Now, these paired parables, where you have the tower builder and the king going to war, they occur only at Luke 14, verses 28 through 33. Now, the verses immediately preceding 28 through 33, Luke 14, 25 to 27, Jesus says, now great crowds accompanied him, and he turned and said to them, if anyone comes to me, this is the parallel you see of Matthew 10:37. The concept is the same, love less, hate being a Semitic idiom. But he says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life. If you don't consider me more important, higher than they are, a greater priority in your life than your father, mother, wife, brothers, sisters, all of this, even your own life. Your own life. So, okay, if relationships don't get the point across to you, if you consider even your own life as having a greater priority than you give to me, anybody like that, what? He cannot be my disciple. He can't. He cannot be my disciple. So this looks pretty serious to me. I mean, this idea of lukewarm Christianity, this idea of kind of a, you know, Rotary Club Christianity, that I don't see that here. What I see, the call of Christ is to this uncompromising, radical, serious commitment. And the church is to be comprised of those people. Because he says, if you will not put me in that position, you cannot be my disciple. You do not have the option of creating your own version of Christianity. Of saying, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to give him something. I'll come and sing some. I might even read the Bible some. But I'm not letting him in to control my life. I'm not letting him come in and tell me how I'm to live. He's not going to rearrange my relationship with my wife. He's not going to get me to love my wife as he loves the church. Not going to do that. She doesn't deserve that. I'm not going to do it, period. Cannot be my disciple. We're talking about disciples. We're talking about people who have said yes to the Lord Jesus, and when he reaches in anywhere, then your answer is what? You're the Lord. Does that mean the journey will be easy? You know better than that. But do you see the difference there where you say, I set my heart and goal to be the person Jesus calls me to be, and he calls me to honor my wife that way? And so that's what I'm doing. However imperfectly I limp toward that objective, I am going to set my heart to be the person that God calls me to be in Christ. And you can put this and apply this to all kinds of things. He says, whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. So having laid out for them, right, let me read you. So this is then before, in 14:25-27. That's right before. Then he says in 28-33, for which of you, okay, you see this four. He gives them this tremendous cost of discipleship. And then he says, for which of you, desiring to build a tower, does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he's laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, ha, this guy began to build and wasn't able to finish. What a clown. What a boaster. What a joke. Or what king going out to encounter another king in war will not sit down first and deliberate whether he's able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? And if not, while the other is yet a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. He does not embark on the battle. He does not engage the battle. Because why? He sits down beforehand and says, I can't complete that. I can't finish that task, that enterprise, So what does he do? He doesn't begin it. He sends somebody and sues for peace. You see? And he says, so therefore, any one of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. Listen to this. Don't suck up what is Christianity from, you know, what you feel and what the world's telling you and what you're picking up on television or on the radio. What is he saying? What is he saying here? So having laid out this costly commitment in verses 25 to 27 that's necessary for being a disciple, Jesus, in this parable, these parables, he gives the reason for his having done so. Why did you lay out for us in Luke 14, 25 to 27, the tremendous cost and sacrifice involved in falling in behind you? Why did you do that? Well, he gives the reason for doing so. That's why I pointed you to the four. He's explaining why he laid out the cost of discipleship. He's done it because, as the parables that he's just given here show, only a fool would embark on an enterprise without first considering whether he has sufficient resources to complete it. An assessment that requires an understanding of what the enterprise will demand or cost. Why did you give us the demands and the costs of discipleship? Because only a fool would embark on discipleship without assessing whether he has the resources to do it. That's what the parables teach. So I'm telling you what the cost is so you can make that assessment. What you cannot do is change it. I'm giving you the truth of the matter so you can go in with open eyes and decide, will I follow the Lord Jesus or not? That's what he's doing, you see. Given the need to know the cost of an enterprise in order to evaluate whether to embark on it. The need that he illustrates there in the parables, Jesus says in verse 33, so therefore, any of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. Okay, he laid out the costly commitment of discipleship in verses 26 and 27. He gave the reason for his laying out the cost of discipleship. He does that in the two parables, and then he repeats the cost of discipleship in different wording as something the parable showed that they needed to know. So that's what's going on here. That's what he's telling us. The parables are not about us building towers or us winning wars. Building a tower and fighting a war, they're merely elements of the parables that are analogous to the decision to become a disciple, in that wisdom dictates that one weigh what is involved before beginning the enterprise. You see, that's it. He gives you these things that say, you have to go in open-eyed. You can't be slipped in. You can't be brought into the kingdom and say, don't worry about it. No, you're good. Don't worry about anything. No, he's not going to affect your life. You're almost there anyway. I mean, hey, come on, you don't have to change anything. You just come on in and just get in the water and get baptized. You get baptized. I'm all for baptism. But baptism without this kind of open-eyed surrender is meaningless. A person who has not come to see Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and said, I'm giving you everything. A person who comes to the waters of baptism who is not penitent just gets wet. I don't care what we say over them. You see? A person must come and say, I see it, Lord. And this is the Spirit. Just bowed, broken. Broken. I give you everything. And in that spirit, one is baptized into Christ. You see, we often say at weddings that marriage is not to be entered into lightly or unadvisedly. I'm sure you've heard that at weddings. Well, how much more do you think that goes for discipleship? How much more? Does it go for discipleship? I'm going to read to you how a number of scholars summarize the meaning of the parables. And I quote so many of them at such length because I believe these parables address something crucial that, in my judgment, is too often underplayed. David Wenham says, both parables emphasize the dangers of undertaking projects that are too costly in terms of money or life, and the need for realistic forward planning. The point of the parables in Jesus' teaching is to emphasize the need for intending followers of Jesus to weigh up the heavy cost of what they're undertaking. Do we ever say that? About a heavy cost? That wasn't the second bell, was it? Okay. What is the cost? Jesus has spoken in the immediately preceding context of the need for would-be followers of his to hate father, mother, wife, children, brother, sister, even his own life, and to take up the cross. What Jesus is doing, as is clear from Matthew's equivalent passage, Matthew 10, 37, 38, is speaking of priorities and of the need for the revolution of God to take precedence over all other commitments, even family commitments. But the costs of discipleship are greater than this. Jesus speaks of hating even one's own life and taking up the cross. And then after the parables of the builder and the king, he says bluntly, any one of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. The revolution is not a spare time activity or club that can be tacked onto a secular lifestyle. It involves hating family, material possession, and one's own life and safety. In short, it demands total commitment such as Jesus himself exemplified. The revolution is something total in its glory and promise, but also in its present demands. Blomberg properly cautions, but to renounce all does not necessarily mean literally to abandon all. As noted above, Jesus sometimes does make that demand of an individual, but many times he does not. Rather, the idea is of one giving up anything which would stand in the way of full-fledged service for Christ. And this is the idea. Well, I have a few others, but we'll see how we work that next week. Thanks for coming.